And we will pray before we get started. Okay, by then I think some of our other friends will also join us. So that'll be good. Anyone, could you please lead with a word of prayer and we'll get started for today.
I'll pray, Pastor.
Yes, yes, sir. Please. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Father, for blessing this another new week to learn your word. Lord, as we go deeper in soak in your word, and as Pastor is going to sow your word, Lord Father, give her wisdom and revelation, Lord, and prepare our heart, our mind, so that, Lord Father, we will be like the good soil that produces 100,000-fold. So for your kingdom, so Lord Father, I submit all the students, Pastor Nancy, into your hand. In Jesus' most precious name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, Arin. As you all know, we will be studying through the books of 1 to 3 John, the epistles that John wrote, and also the book of John, which is the eyewitness account that John wrote about the life of Jesus. So this is our content for this particular course. The way we are going to go through each of these epistles and then finally the book is, we will begin with the epistles. Okay? So First John, and then we will do Second John, Third John, and then move on to the book of John. So as we start off, anything y'all know about John the Apostle and his writings?
Yes, ma'am. John wrote Revelation book.
Okay, okay. What else? Who was he?
One of favorite disciples, ma'am.
Okay, one of Jesus's favorite disciples. So he says, in his writings, you see, you know, beloved disciple, he has written that about himself. So I don't know. I mean, did the others also think that he was Jesus's beloved? We don't know. But of course, he had, yes, Thomas.
Sorry, ma'am. I don't know what's happening. The voice is too low, yours and others as well. Maybe I have to check in my mobile as well. I don't know.
Okay.
Book of John, it's a very unique gospel among the four gospels where he writes the revelation and Jesus is before the creation. He's a word. John got the deepest revelation about who Jesus is and his divinity. He explained in John. And more he talked about the love of God in 1, 2, 3 letters.
Yes.
So he got more revelation than others, and he written more about love than other disciples. Other than Paul, he written very deeper things of love. He says that if you don't know love, you don't know God, because God is love, like those things and all.
Mm.
So his letters are unique.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Thomas, for sharing what you know about John and his writings. I hope you can all hear me quite clearly. Because Thomas...
can hear, but voice is very low. I don't know about others, but for me, it's very low.
Okay. How about the others? Can you hear me well?
Same here, ma'am. Your voice is quite
low.
Yeah.
Okay. Just let me know if it's any better.
It's a bit better now.
Is it better? Is it better?
Yeah, it's a bit better.
Yes. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. Fine. So as long as you can hear me, all right, I will continue. So as I've already told us, we will be going through the writings of John except for Revelation. So in the first epistle of John, which is a letter, okay, epistle is nothing but a letter, we see that he is writing on different themes, and as Thomas pointed out, one of the themes that is common in most of his writings is about the Lord Jesus and the deity of the Lord Jesus. So we will see that here as well. This book and the other books were written by Apostle John. Usually historians, unless they have the name of that person individual in the epistles, it's hard to say, right? Because in Paul's writings, you have an introduction, and then Paul generally says that I am the apostle, bond servant of Christ. So he begins his introduction in that manner. So it's easy for us to recognize that those epistles were actually written by Paul. But in the case of John's epistles, you don't necessarily see his name anywhere. Okay. However, there were disciples of John. One very well-known disciple is Polycarp, Bishop of Smyrna. Many of you would have seen, Polycarp, Bishop of Smyrna, when you read the background of different books of the Bible. So he seems to be a good historian groomed by, John. So like in that line of mentors, so Polycarp testifies to the fact that these books were written by Apostle John, and also Irenaeus, one of the other church fathers during the early times, also testifies that these epistles were written by John the Apostle. So we are clear about the authorship of Apostle John. This John is also the brother of James. Now you would recall there were times when Jesus called John and James as the sons of thunder, okay, in Mark chapter 3. So this is the John that we are referring to, the brother of James. Now both of these people, John and James, when you look at the book of Acts, our batch is also doing the book of Acts, we know that earlier they didn't quite understand what Jesus was doing, and maybe not mature enough. Excuse me. But we notice that these same apostles and disciples who did not stand firmly for Jesus during his trial, so after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, they have all become very bold, and they've lived a powerful life for Christ. So John, he is this apostle who's writing books and providing leadership to the early church. Similarly, James also, he provided leadership to the early church. So both of them were transformed by the work of God. They were leaders at their time. Now the thing about this epistle is that it was written somewhere around AD 90, okay, AD 90, and passed on to the churches. And it's likely that John was, a very well accepted leader by the churches. And in the book of Revelation, you would find there were seven churches that he's talking about. So it's possible that John wrote these teachings, and then it was taken, it was given out to the seven churches. Okay, so he's basically instructing the churches on various aspects. And as Thomas pointed out, one of the key themes of John's writings is the love of God and living a true Christian life where we are walking in the love of God. So what is the intention behind writing these epistles? John, you would notice that he's encouraging the believers, okay, in various cities or churches. And he is warning believers about worldliness and about sin. So that is something we will observe as we go forward. He's also warning the believers about false teaching and false teachers, because as the days go by, the apostles You know, they knew that there will be several such false teachers coming up. So they needed to let the people be cautious. So John is warning them about false teachings. John is also wanting to establish people in the love of God. Okay, so that is another motive he had in writing. And to remind the believers that they are actually overcomers, though they are here in the world and they may be afflicted by various tactics of the evil one. So those are the intentions that John had in writing this particular epistle. This is First John. Okay, we are talking about First John. So as we go to Second John, as we go to Third John, we will see the key motivation that John the Apostle had in writing out those letters as well. So today let us begin with John chapter 1. And I think a good thing to do is to read through the entire passage quickly. We'll do this initially, but I don't think we will keep reading the whole passage in the class. Ideally, if you can read it a couple of times and then come for class, that will be very good. But today, let's do that. Let's go ahead and read 1 John chapter 1, please. So anyone who can start reading it, that will be good. We'll read a few verses at a time and continue. You know, another person can take over after that. Who would like to start?
The first one, First John, verse first, chapter first, verse.
Yes, yes.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life.
Yeah, keep going, Manu.
The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you have, you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. This is
okay. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Manu. Maybe the next person can read 4 verses.
Can I read, ma'am?
Yes, please.
This is the message which we have heard from Him and declared to you, that God is light and Him no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have a fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Can I continue, or... If we say that we have,
one more verse.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceived ourselves, and truth is not in us.
Yeah, thanks, Thomas. The next person, please. 4 verses at a time will be good.
Okay, ma'am.
Oh, two more left. Yeah.
Okay. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us.
Okay. Thank you, Kiran. Thank you so much for that. So you notice here there seem to be 2 sections. Okay, the first section from verse 1 to verse 4, John is simply writing about the Lord Jesus. And the second section, which is from verse 5 to verse 10, he is writing about believers who walk in the truth and thereby walk in the light of God. So we will look at them, these categories. So we'll begin with learning more about Jesus through the introduction of John the Apostle. He starts off by saying that which was from the beginning, that which was from the beginning. Now, which beginning is he referring to? The beginning which he is referring to is even before man was created and put here on the earth. If you look back at Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, the word begins with in the beginning. Okay? In the beginning. In the beginning is, you know, when we think, our minds may not be able to grasp, but we are going way back in the past to that, if you may call it the moment, right? Because God is even outside of time, but there is this beginning where only God existed. So he's talking about that period where you had only the Trinity, right? So there was nothing else, there was no one else but the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and their fellowship among themselves. So in the beginning, God created. Okay, so God existed at that time, and John has a reference to that beginning. So he's saying that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. So he is now talking about the fact that this God, okay, this eternal God, he is not just a mythological figure, because he is providing evidence of the existence of this God. Now, he's saying that he has, along with several other believers, heard, he has seen with his eyes, he has looked upon, and he has handled, whose hands have handled. So, you know, he is referring to the Lord Jesus. We know that the Lord Jesus is the revelation of the Father, and he was sent here to the world. And John's book, when we read it, you will notice even there, he begins with the introduction of the Lord Jesus as in the beginning the Word of God, right? So the Word of God is the Logos, the Lord Jesus himself. And John has interacted with Jesus, okay? The second person of the Trinity, the second person of the Godhead. So he is providing evidence for this God, the second person of the Godhead, and he's saying that all our physical senses must have experienced something to be natural, isn't it? So he's saying that his ears have sensed, or they have heard the Lord Jesus. His eyes have seen, so his sense of sight has also experienced the Lord Jesus, which we have looked upon. Looked upon, it could be considered as studied, okay, or deeply understood. He has deeply understood the Lord Jesus, and he is also referring to the fact that their hands have handled. So the sense of touch, right? With all these senses, he has experienced the Lord Jesus. So it is very clear that we are not talking about some imaginary person, but a real human being who existed. Now, this is a beautiful progression, because it begins by talking about the eternal God in the beginning, refers to eternity and the deity of Christ. Okay, but it moves on to the humanity of Christ, where the physical being of the Lord Jesus here on the earth is being clarified to the listeners. Now, this is important, because during the times of Jesus, there were several teachings, and one particular line of thought was Gnosticism, where they knew that Jesus was special, but they did not really believe that he was completely human. So thereby, the sufferings that the Lord Jesus went through, for them, it wouldn't mean that he is the Messiah. he carried some kind of supernatural powers through which he was able to bear the pain of the trial, the, you know, a very excruciating pain when he was beaten and put on the cross. And so if he was not human, you know, then we are denying what God did through Jesus as that atonement price for us. So there were several such teachings that denied the humanity of Christ. But John, you know, beautifully he is intertwining the deity and the humanity of God. So he was 100% God because he was already existent in the right at the beginning. And he's 100% man because, you know, he was a physical person. And John is saying that he has personally experienced this Christ. And he moves on to reveal the Lord Jesus as the Word of Life. Okay? Now, again, in John chapter 1 and verse 1, can somebody read that passage, please? John chapter 1 and verse 1.
In the beginning was the Word, yes. And the Word, yes, was with God, and the Word was God.
Yeah, very good. So again, in John chapter 1, see, this is the revelation which Apostle John has, that in the beginning was the Word, okay? And the Word was with God, the Word was God. He's talking about Jesus. And then as you read the passage, you will see, he says the Word became flesh. So the Logos, or the written Word of God, the revealed Word of God, is Christ Jesus himself. Now, he has begun an introduction of the Lord Jesus, and he is adding to that and saying that he is the Word, but he adds here of life. Okay, so Logos of life. What is that term for life there? It is the word Zoe, okay? Zoe. And Zoe means the God kind of life, okay? Or the life that flows from God, and the life that flows in God. So it is a supernatural kind of life that God carries. And the Word of Life, so the Logos, or the Word of God, who carries the life of God. Okay, so that is the introduction of the Lord Jesus. Now you notice, this everything is an explanation about the Lord Jesus. So basically you could call this the study of Christ or Christology. And John is giving us a revelation of Christ in the very first chapter, very similar to the book of John, where he describes that the Word became flesh. Now, notice in verse 2, he says, the life was manifested, the Word became flesh. Word of life, Word of Zoe, God kind of life was flowing through him, and that life was manifested. Manifested is appeared, okay? It was made real before our eyes. And again, he testifies as an eyewitness and says, we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. Okay? So he is reiterating the same thing, that the Lord Jesus is eternal, and he also became a human being. So that's the point that he's making once again. Now, a couple of other things that you notice here, you know, he says, we have seen, we bear witness, okay, which means that he is ready to affirm or testify of the deity and the humanity of Christ. And he's saying not just know it, but declare or proclaim, or to tell you, I'm here to tell you that eternal life which was with the Father, okay? Eternal life which was with the Father, again referring to the Lord Jesus, we've already seen one title which was given to him, which is the Word of Life. Now he's saying the life of God himself, okay, in that sense he's equating the Lord Jesus and the life that the Godhead carries. And he's saying that eternal life which was with the Father was manifested to us. So again, eternal and at the same time became physical and natural. So the deity of Christ and the humanity of Christ. Now moving on to verse 3, it says, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you. You see, it's really beautiful in the case of the disciples of Christ during that time. Like, you would say from the time of 30 AD to all the way, I don't know how long people lived, but since John is written at 90 AD, maybe there were people who lived on, right, 60 years, 70 years, so up to 100 AD. But these people were not talking out of some written account of another historian or a learned person, but this was their own experience. You notice how many times he is saying that I am a witness of this, which we have heard, our eyes have seen, we have looked upon, we have handled. Again, he comes back to saying, we have seen, we bear witness, and we declare. And once again, he's making that point and saying, we have seen and heard, we declare to you. So what a privilege, isn't it, that physically they have observed all these things, and so they were sure of the truth. Okay, and in those times, if you look at the writings and the eyewitness accounts of the Lord Jesus, you would know that incidents were accurate, because several others are also written about it, and there is that accuracy in it. So these are all eyewitness accounts, and we can be sure of the message that it is bringing to us. So John is saying that I am talking out of experience, and so believe me, the eternal was made manifest in the natural, and he's actually talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, why is he declaring it to us? Okay. So that is the next flow of thought here. He says, verse 3, the second part, that you also may have fellowship with us. That you also may have fellowship with us. Okay, so the revelation of the Lord Jesus, what does it cause us to do? It causes us to worship him. But it also helps us relate to him in a stronger and a deeper way. So that's why for us to get closer to God, we can spend time in the Word of God, because the Word of God will reveal God to us. So what are we really doing? We are interacting, we are engaging, we are, in other terms, we are communing, right, with God. So that revelation will make us go closer to God. And it must cause us to fellowship with God. So that is the reason John is writing these things, so that the churches who heard these messages will be enthused, they will be encouraged, and they will know Christ in a deeper way and have a, he uses the term, fellowship with us. And this word fellowship, I'm sure many of you have heard it. It is koinonia. Okay, koinonia. And koinonia simply means partnership and participation. Okay, so this comes out of communion with God. And this is a Greek word which is used for fellowship. So the intention which John the Apostle had is that the believers would go ahead and interact, fellowship with God himself. Okay, now, when we look at this term koinonia, it's not just about knowledge of God. And when you say interaction, it doesn't mean that you just touch base, you have some updates going, and that's about it. But koinonia refers to a communion where there is a two-way interaction, where one person shares, the other person listens, and similarly, you know, the other person shares and the next person listens. So there is this whole getting to know one another and, you know, growing together. So partnership, that kind of a partnership is what he is referring to. So far he's talked about the life of God. Okay? So the life of God is introduced, and he really wants the believer to participate in that life, to have that life and to have that communion with God, from where they can draw that life of God. So God is being introduced, or Christ is being introduced, so that the believer can have a taste of it and walk in who God is and experience that life which God has. And that is John's intention. So I declare everything to you. Now you can have what is there in the Godhead. You can have what this eternal word, this word that was manifested, you know, came to give us. So his introduction is so that the believer can experience this Christ. So he says, you know, that you also may have fellowship with us. All right. Now, also may have fellowship with us shows us that he and he uses the term us. Okay, so he and the ones who were obedient to God and who were following after God, you know, they could experience the Godhead and all that the Godhead is about. And he continues to say, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. So while the human fellowship is important, he kind of shifts the focus to the fellowship that he and you know, believers at his time had with the Godhead itself. Okay, so we too can have fellowship with the Godhead. How can we have fellowship with the Father? Anybody? What are the ways in which we can fellowship with the Father? Your thoughts? How did Jesus fellowship with the Father? Through prayer. Okay, excellent. Yeah, yeah. So prayer is a means by which we can fellowship with the Father, and our fellowship with the Son by taking time in the Word of God, right? We could have fellowship with the Son. So there are many ways in which we can fellowship with the Father. We can fellowship with the Son. But the notable thing here is that God has given us an audience in the Godhead itself. So isn't it a beautiful thought that you and I can interact with God? We can commune with God. We can commune with the Father, the Son, and though the Holy Spirit is not mentioned here, we have other scriptures, right? Like in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, we see that, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, where we are taught about the koinonia, or the fellowship with the Holy Spirit. So we can engage with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and that is the privilege of every believer. So at times when we feel lonely, we feel that, you know, there's nobody, I don't have anybody. But honestly, for a believer, we always have the Godhead, and we can commune with the Godhead. We can fellowship with the Godhead, and our journey in fellowshipping with the Godhead will be through the revelation that we have of the Godhead. So the more we know about the Father, the more we know about Jesus, the more we know about the Holy Spirit. And when I say know, it's not a head knowledge, but, you know, experientially, in a way where we are seeking God to understand him and to live for him. So when we know him in that way, truly we are experiencing that fellowship with God, and we have that privilege as believers. So John is calling us to fellowship with the Godhead. And in verse 4, he says, and these things we write to you that your joy may be full. So through the words of exhortation that John is bringing the believers, his intention is for the believers to rejoice. Okay, at the word joy here, for a lot of us, the confusion is between joy and happiness. Happiness is a state of well-being, a state of rejoicing when circumstances are positive. But joy is a state of rejoicing even when circumstances are not proper, right? So John wants us to understand that when we are fellowshipping with the Godhead, when we are living with the revelation of the Godhead, you know, there is this internal, if you may call it, from the Spirit, a sense of well-being, sense of rejoicing that you and I can have, and this comes through the Holy Spirit. If you recall, scriptures tell us that righteousness, peace, and joy, that's the kingdom of God. So it is birthed in us. It is birthed in us by the work of the Holy Spirit. And this is the kingdom of God that has been given to us. So we can always have the kingdom, right? The kingdom is not given and it's gone 1 minute. Not at all. But we've already received of it and we can have this joy. And he wants the believer to experience that steady rejoicing of the Spirit. And he's saying that he's writing these things so that the believer can have fellowship with the Godhead, and also that he might have joy. What kind of joy and how much of joy? Now he says that you may be full, right? And these things we write to you that your joy may be full. So the believer should experience the fullness of joy. So in knowing God, in knowing the Father, in fellowshipping with the Father, we have that experience of the fullness of joy. So for John, revealing the Godhead was an important thing. And notice how, though the term Trinity is not mentioned, there is a distinction that John is making and saying that there are separate persons. So, you know, Jesus, the Son, fellowship with the, he could have just said fellowship with God, but he's making a distinction. Fellowship with the Son, fellowship with the Father. So the Trinity is coming through very clearly in these first few verses of the epistle of John. So these are some highlights from the first four verses. Now we will continue and we will go through the next section here, which has to do more with the fellowship of human beings or with our fellow believers. Okay, so that is the second section. Before that, are you all doing okay? Any thoughts, any comments? Is it too fast? Or you're comfortable with the pace? Just let me know.
Comfortable, ma'am.
Okay, great. Then that's good. So you've understood the first section. Then we'll move on to the second section. So here in the second section, from verse 5, he says that this is the message which we have heard from him and declared to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. So you notice it's one revelation after the other, right? And the revelation is about God. Jesus, when he walked the earth, he made the statement and said, you know, I am the light of the world. And John also says the same thing. He says that God is light. In him, there is no darkness at all. You know, it seems like a given, obviously. Light and darkness are completely different. How can there be any darkness in the light? So, this, the statement that he's making that in itself clarifies some of the thoughts that he is going to share later on. Basically, it's about righteousness and sin. And he's giving us this distinction and saying these are two separate entities. Okay, you can't mix the two and say, okay, there's a little bit of light which lives with the darkness, and that is normal. And there is a little bit of darkness that lives with the light. Okay, so that just cannot happen. So he begins with this very clear example and an illustration and says, you know, God, it's more than an illustration, it's true that God himself is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. So he's talking about the holiness of God. He's talking about the purity of God. And he is teaching us that we must have a clear view of our God, okay, and his standards. So when we get an idea of that, we will know what kind of life we need to live. And the standard that God has set for himself in his own nature, it is very, very high. We see that God is light, and to make it clarify it further, he says in him there is no darkness at all, which means to say that, you know, God is completely, like, he's very pure, and there is you know, nothing in him which is sinful. So God is light. Verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. So now he's coming to the point. He's saying that we've understood God is a holy God, and we have access to God. We can fellowship with God. But if we say that we are fellowshipping with God, and if we walk in darkness, in other words, this is referring to a sinful lifestyle. Okay. Now, for us, we might have this question, you know, is he talking about for making a mistake? Sometimes we stumble. Sometimes we stumble and we repent, we confess our sins, and we come back to God. Well, John is talking about sinning, but the context in which he is referring to sinning is, you know, a lifestyle where somebody is unwilling to change, and they have made a practice and a habit of sin, and they're not ready to give up. So, you know, that seems to be the context in which he is talking about sin. And what he's saying here is, he's saying that as believers, we could say that I have a strong relationship with God. I have a deep fellowship, koinonia, communion with God. Okay, but at the same time, we could have habits, attitudes within ourselves where we are unwilling to yield to the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit might be convicting us about, I'm just taking an example, unforgiveness in our hearts, okay, or bitterness that we are carrying against a brother or a sister in Christ, or maybe a family member. But we still hold on to that bitterness, and we don't let go of it, though the Holy Spirit is ministering constantly with regard to that issue. And yet, we are going about our you know, Bible reading, our spiritual walk with the Lord, our schedule of prayer and fasting and so many things. But God wants to remind us that, you know, the practices are okay, but true fellowship is in obedience. True fellowship is in following after the very nature of God, which is sinless. God is holy, and he wants us to be holy. So whenever he convicts us of a wrong lifestyle, some habits which do not glorify him, we must get rid of those things right away, because only then we are having true fellowship with God. Otherwise, you imagine, how is it possible for us to interact in a right way with God? Because we are not being honest, right? We are not being honest. So that's what he's saying here in verse 6. He says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, he very strongly puts this across and says that we lie. So it's a life of self-deception. You know, one of the most dangerous things for any human being, and particularly a believer, is self-deception, where we think we are right, but by the standards of God, we are not right. Okay, but we've convinced ourselves that the truth is different. So that is self-deception. And John is pointing that out and saying that if we do not walk righteously and in holiness, we are speaking lies to ourselves. And don't think that God doesn't recognize that. So he says we lie and do not practice the truth. Okay, so truth has to be practiced. A righteous way of living has to be practiced. So he says that we must respond to God immediately in repentance let go of our sinful lifestyle, and only then we are practicing the truth. Okay, verse 7, he says, but on the contrary, so he says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light. So this is about the Christian lifestyle, the Christian journey. So walk refers to the journey. Okay? Every believer has to walk through their life. So whatever we hear, that needs to be put into practice. Our faith is not just a matter of listening, but it's a matter of living out our lives. And that's where he's coming to now. He's saying, but if we walk in the light, again, it's like if you practice the truth, if you practice living a righteous life as he is in the light. So God is truth, God is light, and he is always in the light. There is no darkness in him, meaning he is holy, he is pure, he is righteous. Now we are also following after that. We are living our lives according to the nature of God, in the right standards of God. He says it's only then that we have fellowship, not just with God, okay, the right kind of fellowship, not just with God, but he says we have fellowship with one another. We have our relationships as believers. Even that is mended and healed. It is blessed and thriving when we walk in righteousness. So walking in righteousness, it will strengthen our relationship with God, and it will also strengthen our relationship with one another. And he continues to say, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So what is he saying here? He's saying that what Jesus did on the cross, now that is the ultimate atonement price. He has paid the ransom for all of us. And the blood of Jesus Christ, which was shed on the cross, he's using a present continuous. It cleanses us from all sin, meaning even right now, there is power in the shed blood of Jesus, which was actually shed 2000 years ago. But that power, he's talking about that cleansing work of the blood. Now that blood is able to clean us up only when we walk in righteousness. So, it's interesting. It's interesting. So basically, his point is that even if we sin, right, we must come back to God. We must acknowledge that sin. And then what are we doing? We are allowing the work of the blood of Jesus to be done in us. But if we do not acknowledge, then we are not letting the blood of Jesus cleanse us, even though it has the power at all times to cleanse our sins, right? So we must walk in the light. And that is the emphasis here, to tell the believer that you must live right before God, and that will help us have right fellowship with God, right fellowship with one another. And if at all there is any sin in our lives, the blood of Jesus will continue to clean us up, so we stand righteously before God. So at this point, we will stop, we will take a break, we'll come back in 10 minutes and continue with 1 John chapter 1, the last few verses. Thank you.